We hear Zephyr's voice, or voices, but we don't see him during the blackout. But backstage we hear, and Zephyr appears.
Every story needs a teller. That's me. And a listener. That's you. All the stories have their secrets, what's untold. But I, Zephyr, god of the west wind, creep through crevices, sneak into corners, hide in cracks, and listen to everything. I gather all the stories, and I know all the secrets. The story I bring you now, the oldest, newest, saddest, happiest story in the world, is about two lovers, a god, Eros, and a mortal, Psyche.
We see them briefly. Eros wearing his torn t-shirt, and Psyche reading a book wearing glasses.
Psyche was no ordinary mortal. She lived in a castle with her father and mother, the king and queen, and two older sisters. She spent most of her time in her room reading, only venturing onto her balcony to feed the birds.
Chirp, 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 chirp.
She was widely praised as the most beautiful girl on earth. You'd think this would make her happy, but Psyche was lonely. She didn't have a best friend. The other girls were jealous, and she didn't have a boyfriend. She seemed to them like a marble statue, dazzling, unattainable. What do you think, Psyche?
It's true. I hate it. I would rather be ordinary. Besides, I don't think what a person looks like should be as important as, well, I don't know, other things.
Such as?
Kindness, courage. But will I ever have those qualities? I wonder.
All that reading had made Psyche wonder about a lot of things.
The king and queen come in. And to be honest with you, the king and I are worried sick about her. I keep saying, Psyche, it's not good to sit around in your room all the time. You should get your hair done, go to parties, meet some nice boys.
Get married, like your sisters did. Find me another rich son-in-law. But see, she refuses to listen.
We're at our wits' end.
You see, Psyche's two older sisters,
Avni
and De Grey, were wed to Lord Bilious Belch and his cousin, Lord Felix Flatulent.
Both extremely influential.
And extremely rich.
If only our dear, darling baby sister could have a husband like mine. Handsome.
Charming.
Generous.
Passionate. But Zephyr knew what they secretly thought. Lord Bilious Belch was...
ancient, even older than father. Bald as an onion. Ugly as a plucked chicken. And stingy to boot.
As for Lord Felix Flatulent?
He's a gluttonous pig, a stinky, noisy and smelly, bad-tempered and boring. His snoring keeps me awake all night. And you would not believe the other sounds he makes.
Now, Abney and De Grey were pretty enough.
What do you mean? Pretty enough. We're super gorgeous.
Especially me. But only on the outside. Psyche, however, was beautiful both outside and inside.
What good is beauty on the inside? Nobody can even see it. And like, where on the inside? Large intestines? The appendix? Where?
And now, here comes the god Eros, son of Zeus, the baddest boy on Olympus.
There he goes again. Come on, hot shot, draw that bow. Aim that arrow, let it go. One quick swing, he'll never know what hit him with the force of a volcano. Eros aims his arrow off stage. Bullseye! And he comes in on his fly cycle. Comes down the aisle on his fly cycle. Yay, Eros, you did it again. Eros, you're divine, like a chubby little cherub on the valentine. You got the wings to prove it, dude, you do. You rock those wings and that tattoo.
Eros,
you wild and crazy guy. Troublemaker, agitator, home wrecker, heartbreaker. Break his heart, make him sick, make him dizzy for a chick. Ooh, Eros, you're incendiary. Setting fires of love in strangers. causing wrecked romance and dangers. You're the baddest, baddest boy in town. Born to be wild.
And back to Earth. A rare psyche sighting. She's returning her library book without her bodyguards.
Look, here she comes. It's really psyche. Oh, she's stunning.
Awesome.
Sublime.
Divine.
Celestial.
Angel.
Goddess.
I adore you.
Me too.
As she reached the crowd, their jaws dropped in shock and awe.
Oh. Hail to you, O psyche. O goddess of love and beauty. Take these flowers we were planning to give to Aphrodite.
Aphro who?
Aphrodite. She is so yesterday. I'm going to worship Psyche instead.
Me too. Psyche's the goddess for me. Of course, news of this soon reached Olympus and Aphrodite herself.
Eros. She's holding the Olympic Inquirer newspaper. Have you seen today's Olympic Inquirer? Mortal declared goddess. Aphrodite's temples deserted as mobs worship earthlings. See?
She's okay.
Then you agree. Oh, it's an outrage that I, Aphrodite, the queen of love and desire, being upstaged by a mortal.
You're right, Ma. You know you're my best girl.
My reckless, impetuous boy, how like your father, Zeus, you are, shooting your arrows everywhere, breaking up marriages, thumbing your nose at earthlings and gods, too, creating chaos and getting away with it. Oh, how I do adore you. And now, my son, you must do this one thing for me. We'll make Psyche or Seki or Paseki or whatever her name is as ugly. Wish she was as ugly as a toad. Here's my plan. Now pay attention. There's this warthog. He's a huge, ugly, bad-tempered creature. Tonight, make yourself invisible, harness the warthog, fly through Psyche's window. She'll be asleep, that brazen hussy. Tie that ugly hog where she'll see it when she opens her eyes, then aim that arrow of your sweet Eros, the arrow that always finds its mark. When she opens her eyes, she'll be love-struck, wounded to the heart by overpowering, passionate love for a pig. Oh, if only I could see it. You will remember every little detail for your mama, won't you, precious?
Ma, that seems a little harsh, maybe even cruel. She's just an earthling.
Eros, please. I am the mother who bore you. It's your filial duty to exact my revenge.
Eros had to look up filial in the Mount Olympus Direct Dictionary. He found it meant son's duty, so he obeyed, reluctantly. First, he made himself invisible. Not to you, of course. Then, the warthog. Ah, this must be the one.
This is the actor in the pig mask. Hooves and corkscrew tail, snuffling pig noises.
A huge, ugly, bad-tempered creature. Harness the hog. Nothing to it. Come on, pig.
They circle each other, pig pawing the ground and snuffling, resisting. Eros lassos him.
Fly to Earth through Psyche's open window. That must be the one. Ready, pig? Shh, you'll wake her up. Cease your protests, prickly porker. Be still, I say. Then, a shaft of moonlight came through the window. Wow, she's beautiful, all right. Too beautiful for the fate that Mother has in mind.
Still, Eros reached back to pluck an arrow from his quiver. The hog squealed. Psyche woke up. Invisible Eros looked deep into her beautiful eyes, accidentally scratched his own arm with the point of the arrow, and fell deeply in love. Eros stood gazing at Psyche for the first time. Eros was overwhelmed by his own superpower of love.
From this moment, she is the most precious thing in the world to me. I swear, with all my heart, never to let any harm befall her.
Having sworn this, Eros quickly escaped through the window and returned to Aphrodite. Oh my Zeus in Olympus! Eros, what in the world's the matter with you? You look terrible. Are you coming down with a virus?
When Eros told her what had happened, she was furious.
You shot the arrow into your own arm? How could you be so reckless? When I think of the money I've spent on archery lessons, I'm going to put an end to that troublesome girl right now.
No, you won't. It was you that started all the trouble, Mom.
And now you're talking back to me after all I've done for you?
I love Psyche. I'm sworn to protect her.
What will the neighbors say? Gods don't marry mortals. It isn't done. It's never been done. Never. Well, there's Orpheus and Eurydice. But you know how that ended. You will destroy our reputation on Olympus. I won't allow it. I will destroy her first.
Mother, if you do anything to harm Psyche, hurt a single hair on her head, I will stop the entire universe from falling in love. No chickens will lay eggs. No fish will spawn. No couples will get married. The fires of love will turn to ashes. No one will ever worship the goddess of love again.
Okay. Okay, you win. On this time, on three conditions.
Name them.
First, you must win this girl's love without using your bow and arrow. Second, she must never know you're a god. And...
Yes?
Last, and most important, she must trust you. If that trust is broken, she'll never see you again. Remember, I will be watching. One false step and...
Eros went to figure out his next move, and Psyche, thinking she'd really had a strange dream... went back to sleep. The next morning, the king and queen were horrified at finding...
A wild warthog running around our daughter's bedroom?
What a stench. It's a veritable pig poopery.
She must be cursed.
We must consult the oracle immediately.
All this trouble must come from your side of the family, Reginald. In mine, we never had any trouble with swine.
The king and the queen didn't waste any time booking an appointment with the oracle, clairvoyant, who met them in her dim, spooky cave. We beg you, Miss Voyant. We are in distress. Please help us.
You seek to know your daughter's destiny. Psyche will be wed to a creature not human, neither man nor beast, feared by all. She might be better off dead. Perhaps prepare her for her wedding procession and proceed to the edge of the highest cliff. There you will leave her. Then she will meet her fate. I, clairvoyant, have spoken.
So, weeping and wailing, her mother and father and sisters dressed poor, doomed Psyche in a wedding gown, put a crown of flowers on her head, and bid her farewell.
Goodbye, sister. I hope the monster doesn't eat you alive.
And if he does, I hope it doesn't hurt too much. And then they left poor Psyche alone at the edge of the cliff with the cruel rocks below. Psyche herself accepted clairvoyant's command. As if in a dream, walked without protest to the edge of the cliff and leapt into my arms. I, Zephyr, the West Wing, Eros' servant and messenger. I gently carried her through the warm, scented air to an enchanted kingdom.
Slow motion, movement to beautiful music. To the count of 12. And he sets her down. Where is the monster? He must be hiding. Is he hiding? Is he waiting for me?
But she didn't hear any growls or roars. Instead, she heard beautiful music.
What music? In the air or from the earth?
Psyche found herself in a world she'd never seen before. Full of flowering meadows and a little stream, seemingly from nowhere, a glowing torch appeared and led her forth.
A dazzling palace lay ahead with pillars of marble, gilded gates which opened wide as she drew near.
to bid their mistress welcome here. Silken carpets, jeweled walls, and throughout all the palace halls, paintings told of ancient days, stories of love in times long past.
Through scented air, sweet breezes blew, and still that music everywhere told of Eros's loving care. Can she see us?
No, you're invisible like me, but she can hear you. You can see you. Now that she's in good hands, I'll say farewell for now.
We're meeting three new characters, okay? I feel so light. Am I in heaven? No, I can't be because I'm hungry. We'll soon fix that, Miss Psyche. Where are you?
Je suis chef haute cuisine, your cook.
I am curtsy politely, your maid.
I, Benedict Cumberbund, am your butler at your service.
I will wait upon you hand and foot and everything in between.
I will make sure you're attended to according to proper etiquette.
And I have come creating for you the feast. It is a feast, so to begin with, a souffle so light, it is like a cloud in the sky. You will see.
Our master has told us to take very good care of her.
They clap their hands, and other servants bring on a table with food and already set. Another carries on candelabra, a napkin around her neck, and another pours wine. All are invisible. Psyche is astonished. You spoke of your master? Please, when may I meet him?
Our master, the one who has brought you here.
Yes, where is he now?
He is perhaps hunting in the hills.
Or swimming in the sea.
Or riding his fly cycle.
He will visit you later. After Psyche has eaten her fill of the delicious food.
You must be all tuckered out, all that worrying and fretting. So awfully upsetting. Have yourself a hot bath with lots of bubbles to forget your heartache and ease your troubles.
That sounds really good.
We will care for your every need.
In that case, would you please bring me something to read?
The latest bestsellers, Miss Psyche.
Psyche soaked in a bath, perfumed from a flower, and I dried her with towels as soft as down. Then led her to a dimly lit bower, where soon her loving host would be. Curtsy seats Psyche in a high-backed chair. She opens her book, curls up to read. Eros enters behind her, so that Psyche can hear him, but not see him. Is someone there? It seems I'm not alone.
Yes, Psyche, I am with you.
Where are you?
No, please don't turn. I am here. If you wish, you may take my hand.
Are you the one who brought me here?
Yes. I asked my friend Zephyr to deliver you.
I was really scared. I thought I was going to meet a monster.
No, only me.
But why? Why have you brought me here?
It seemed like the only way to keep you safe. I care about you, Psyche. Actually, I guess you could say I care for you very much. I never knew this feeling until I saw you. One day, when you know me better, I hope you will be my bride.
I like your voice. I like the touch of your hand. Do I know you?
No, you have never seen me, but I've been protecting you.
Well, then why can't I see you?
Just hang in there. I swear there will be a time. Until then, you must trust me. Never, never try to look at me, Psyche.
I don't understand. I'm curious.
I know. That's one thing I like about you.
I want to know if you look as nice as you sound.
I understand, but you must do this thing for me. Trust me.
And so it meant for time. Psyche read all the books in the library. She walked in the garden among all the creatures who lived there. What has happened, little fledgling? Oh, dear, have you fallen from your nest? Here, little one, hop up on my finger. Let's get you home to your mama. Don't be afraid. There, good. Now fly away home.
She even made the acquaintance of an industrious ant.
Little ant, scurrying here and there, what's your name? Where are you going in such a hurry? I'm Aunt Hilda. All my family is coming to dinner, so I'm doing some last-minute shopping. Well, here, take this sugar cube with my best wishes. Thank you, kind lady. Every evening at twilight, Psyche looked forward to Eris's visits. But one night, the new little old crescent moon was beginning to rise, and she realized it's almost night. Where can he be? He's never late. Now, Miss Psyche, honey, don't you worry your pretty little head. He'll be along soon, darling. Run on and brush your teeth.
Just then, Psyche heard a roar.
Vroom, vroom, vroom.
See?
Sorry. I got here as fast as I could.
It's okay. I was just worried something had happened to you.
I had some trouble with the fly cycle. The crankshaft rubbed against the Uberdink, the lightning plugs fouled, the engine overheated, and both wing feathers cracked. It took me a while to fix it.
But you're okay now?
All okay.
Oh, that fly cycle of yours sounds so cool. I wish I could see it.
Oh, you will see it and ride it someday. What's that thing in your hand?
A toothbrush. Duh, you know, a toothbrush? For brushing my teeth, you know?
Nope. I have a brush for my hair, but why do you have to brush your teeth?
So Mr. Tooth Decay doesn't give me cavities.
Mr. Tooth Decay? Who in the world is he? Psyche, you are so mysterious and wonderful to me. Someday I want to learn everything about you.
Me too, and I want so much to see you.
I know. It must be frustrating.
Sometimes.
Yes, sometimes. What?
I get lonely, especially after you've gone.
Psyche, my soul, you are missing your family, your sisters.
My sisters. How I'd love to see them.
Maybe I'm wrong to hold you here. Do you want to go home?
Oh, no. Please, no. Curtsy and Benedict and Chef Haute Cuisine take such good care of me, and I love my time with you. The stories you tell me about riding your fly cycle and hunting in the forest with your bow and arrow, it makes me want to go with you to see you even more. Please don't send me away.
Very well. I will ask Zephyr to bring your sisters here to you. And it was so. Before they knew it was happening, I swept Psyche's two sisters, Avni and DeGray, up in a whirlwind.
They enter whirling and whooping. Woo! What's going on? Oh, wee! Ah! Thank Dorothy and Toto. What's happening? Take my hand, Avni! Grab my foot, DeGray!
Something told me those two were up to no good, so I set them down with a bump. They wobble around like drunken sailors.
Wow, that was a trip.
My hair's a mess.
I'm quite upset.
I've torn my dress.
I broke a heel.
My wig is gone.
What in the world is going on? Sisters, Avni, DeGray, I've missed you so much.
Psyche, we thought you were dead.
We thought the monster ate you up. No, you can see I'm fine. But both of you look a little windblown. Never mind. Curtsy politely, my maid will take care of that. Cummerbund, Cuisine, please fix Avni's shoe and DeGray's hair. Don't worry that you can't see them. They're invisible. So they react to being fixed up by the invisible people. All better. Tell me, sisters, how was your trip? Well, we were at the country club, right in the middle of dessert.
I was eating a double hot fudge sundae, and suddenly...
there was this ginormous windstorm, and here we are.
Psyche showed her sisters through the gardens and around the castle. They saw the sauna and the beauty salon and her wardrobe of dresses. She wanted them to know she was well taken care of. At first, Avni and DeGray oohed and aahed, happy to be reunited with their baby sister. But pretty soon... their joy soured and quickly turned to jealousy.
These carpets? Pure silk.
That chandelier's emeralds.
And this wallpaper's made of real gold.
The tables are inlaid with rubies and pearls.
It's worth a huge fortune. Its value untold. Tell us, dear sister, we're so happy for you.
We're that you're alive and not dead.
And that you're rich and not poor.
But tell us, who owns this castle?
Well, my host and I guess.
And all that's inside it?
Well, yes, that's what he said.
Host?
He?
Who?
He who? Do you mean the monster? No, not a monster. I'm quite sure he's no monster. She's quite sure.
Tell us more.
Where is he now,
your host?
Out hunting in the forest.
How could a simple hunter be so rich?
Well, I think he has lots of interests.
You think? Don't you know? Haven't you met him?
Of course. He visits me every night. He's the one who'll be my husband.
Your husband?
That's what he told me when I'm ready.
When she's ready.
What does he look like? I've heard his voice. I've touched his hands, but...
Yes?
I haven't actually seen him.
Psyche! Now, we don't want to upset you, but this sounds truly suspicious.
You know our sole concern is your well-being, Psyche dear.
We're happy you're not dead.
We're thrilled by your good fortune.
True, your gown is trimmed with sapphires and your hair is bound with pearls.
And the food you serve here is to die for. But
we cannot help but worry who your host might be.
A serpent filled with poison?
A demon spewing spite?
Or a two-headed dragon who could spread his wings in flight?
Even worse, a devil witch, shape-changer.
Double danger.
One creature in the daytime, a different one at night.
Why won't he let you see him?
Remember the oracle. Clairvoyant, remember what she said.
Not man nor beast, but feared by all. Better you were dead.
If what clairvoyant says is true...
We know she does not lie.
What's your fate, dear Psyche?
What will happen by and by?
When will you be ready? Ready for what?
Is he fattening you up? Getting you ripe, getting you fit to put on a spit and roast you for his dinner?
Beware, heed the words of Claire. Don't wait another night. Here's what you have to do.
There might be spies. No. Must I? Do I have to?
Don't delay. Do what we say.
Oh, sisters, I'm afraid. Not just for me, but for you. You may not be safe. You must go now as fast as Zephyr will carry you. We're going. But remember.
Trust us.
We're your own flesh and blood.
Would we steer you wrong?
Kiss.
Now, doubt is the enemy of love. The sisters, having seen Psyche's treasures, were gorged and glutted with envy. They planted the seed of doubt. Quickly the seed grew until that same night, Psyche waited until she was sure her visitor was asleep. Then she did what her sisters had told her to do. Found a knife, lit a candle, and tiptoed down the shadowy corridor which led to his room. In the darkness she could barely make out a form. What would she find? A witch? A serpent? A dragon? Arrows stirred in his sleep.
Psyche stepped closer and looked down at his face, shining in the candlelight. The dearest, most wonderful face she had ever seen. The face of a man, the face of a god. Astonished, she leaned forward. A drop of candle wax fell on Eros' shoulder. He woke, saw Psyche standing over him.
Psyche, oh no, Psyche, I begged you not to look at me. I've protected you from my mother's wrath, but now you've broken trust. I can protect you no longer. All is destroyed.
And Psyche found herself standing in smoke and ashes. Eros was gone. The castle had vanished. She was alone. And she had wounded the person she had learned to love the most in the whole world.
For days she wandered, shivering and cold. She didn't know where to turn. finally, desperate and heartsick, she found herself at Aphrodite's temple.
Esteemed goddess of love and beauty, I humbly seek your guidance. I have wounded your son in body and in spirit. Please help me regain his trust. Please help me find him. Despicable mortal, you're not worthy of forgiveness or the love of my son, Eros. I know that I'm unworthy. However, I'm not weighed a stone. I will give you 3 chances to prove your devotion. If you fail, you will never see him again. I shall not fail.
Aphrodite pointed to a huge pile of seeds all jumbled together, barley, millet, oats, and wheat.
Sort these seeds by dinner time if you can, which I doubt.
Aphrodite vanished, and Psyche, overwhelmed, began to weep huge, salty tears. Hey, Psyche, watch out. You almost drowned me.
Aunt Hilda. Oh, Aunt Hilda! Oh, I'm so sorry. How are you? How is your family?
They haven't forgotten that sugar cube that you gave them. Why are you crying?
Psyche explained.
Is that all? Heck, I'll call all my friends and relations. We'll make a molehill out of that mountain of grain in no time. Come on, grain by grain, boys, grain by grain. With help from Aunt Hilda and her family, Psyche quickly sorted out the tiny grains into neat piles. Aphrodite demanded the second impossible task.
I'm chilly. I need a shawl. Bring me the fleece of pure gold from the wild man-eating sheep across the river by tomorrow morning.
Psyche walked barefoot through the rough countryside until she came to the river. She could hear the sheep bellowing.
Bah, bah, bah.
She rested for a moment, then she heard a familiar voice.
Chip, 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 chip. Hey there, friend, what brings you here?
Little sparrow, I could ask you the same thing.
I've kept my eye on you ever since that time you found baby fledgling on the ground and returned it to the nest. That was a kind thing for you to do. I understand you're supposed to gather golden fleece from those nasty sheep.
How did you know that?
I get around. Anyway, don't try to do it when the sun is shining bright like it is now. Those sheep have razor-sharp horns and hooves like knives. They'd kill you in a moment. But they're lazy. They like to take naps. Wait until they take a noontime snooze. When we hear them snoring, Fledgling and I will help you gather all the fleece you want from the thorny bramble bushes where they graze.
And so it was. Psyche waded across the river, and while the man-eating sheep were napping, she and Sparrow and Fledgling gathered an armload of golden fleece.
2 down, only 1 to go. Good luck, Psyche. Chip, 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 chip.
And Psyche returned to Aphrodite, who was not pleased that she had completed the first two tasks so quickly. Furthermore, Eros had recovered from his candle wax burn and had not forgotten his Psyche. What's next, Mama? What impossible task will you set for her next? Isn't it enough that the castle and her servants all have disappeared? Isn't it enough that her rotten sisters took advantage of her and that she and I are too?
You don't mean to say that after that wretched mortal betrayed you, you still...
I will always care for her. I will always protect her. I love her.
You love Psyche, seriously. We'll just let her prove once and for all that she's not worth it. Remember, she must do this last task, take this final journey alone.
Aphrodite had saved the best for last.
Are you ready, unworthy mortal? All this strife and worry about my poor son and how you wounded him and how terribly you betrayed his trust, it's worn me out. Descend now into Hades, the hall of the dead, and bring me back a restorative jar of Persephone's pomegranate beauty cream. Be back by my bedtime. I want to use that beauty cream tonight.
Poor Psyche understood suddenly and completely that Aphrodite wanted her dead.
Even if she knew how to find Hades, she didn't have a clue. She knew no one who entered Hades could ever return. Lost and afraid, Psyche cried and cried and cried until finally she didn't have any tears left. Eros enters, disguised as an old lady. With a wig and a cape and a mask.
What's this? Dry your eyes, my child, and tell me, why are you weeping?
I've loved somebody, and I've lost him forever.
Surely that can't be true.
I know he loves you, too.
Eros? You sound like Eros.
No, I'm just a little old lady. I'm certainly not anybody named Eros. See my gray hair, my cape, my wrinkles?
That's funny. For a second there, you sounded like somebody else.
That person you love?
Yes.
Tell me why you're crying and what you need, and maybe I can help you.
So, Psyche explained.
That Aphrodite lady sounds awful to make you do something like that and go where she wants you to go.
Well, she is his mother.
Okay, it still seems like a dirty trick. But if you gotta go to Hades, do just what I say. At the bottom of the hill, look for a rock with a crack. It's a breathing vent to the underworld. You'll find a treacherous path that goes down, down, down. Hades is as far beneath the earth as the earth is beneath the sky. Wait. Take these cakes to feed the three heads of Cerberus, and 2 gold coins to pay Charon the boatman. Whatever you do, don't eat or drink anything, or you will never be allowed to return.
Psyche found the crack, squeezed her way through, and felt her way through gloomy tunnels and halls, past ghastly visions and ghosts of the dead, gave Charon his fare, crossed river Styx, raced past the fury and the wall of fire that licked at her heels. Tossing her cakes to three-headed Cerberus, she swallowed her fear, conquered her dread, thinking of Eros.
Step by painful step, Psyche journeyed forth until, at last, she stood before the throne of Persephone herself.
Welcome to the underworld, my child. What has brought you here? Why have you come all this way?
Honored and holy queen of the underworld, I humbly ask your help. I am sent from Aphrodite to request a very special favor from you.
Proceed, lovely mortal.
Aphrodite has been ill with an illness I myself caused. She requires a jar of your magic pomegranate beauty cream to restore her health.
Of course, I'm happy to share my beauty cream with Aphrodite, the goddess of love. It contains pomegranates, but be careful. It's not meant for mortals.
I thank you, dear Persephone.
You are welcome. Though I'd love to prepare a feast to reward your courage, I know you'd never return to Earth if you ate our food or drank our wine. I do understand better than most the tricks of my dark kingdom. So hurry now. Hurry home to the sun.
Psyche bid Persephone goodbye, wound her perilous way past the ghosts and the ghouls, past the screams and the wailing of tortured lost souls. Though the rocks cut her feet and she faltered and fell, she stumbled on until near the rock's cleft she could see the sun's light, then suddenly thought,
I must look a fright. My hair is all tangled, my clothes are ragged and torn, not a bath or a shower for many a night. What if Eros should meet me? Would he care? Don't know how. He loved me once, but what about now? What if I tried some of her beauty cream? Aphrodite'd have a fit if she guessed, but she surely won't miss just a teensy, teensy bit.
Now, Psyche was usually level-headed, but remember, for days she'd not drunk a sip of water or eaten a crumb of bread. The ordeal had exhausted her good sense. She felt lighthearted and faint and had forgotten Persephone's warning.
Be careful. It's not meant for mortals, mortals, mortals.
No sooner had she turned the lid of the beauty cream than Morpheus, the god of sleep, escaped and threw his cloak around her. Psyche was plunged into a deathly slumber. Eros, faithful Eros, loving Eros, patient and hopeful Eros had waited beside the cleft in the rock.
When he saw Morpheus escape,
He instantly understood what had happened. He threw aside his disguise, squeezed through the cleft, gathered the sleeping Psyche in his arms, flew straight to Olympus, to his father Zeus, told him of his love for Psyche, and begged him to intervene.
Zeus, your mother...
This is Zeus. Okay.
Your mother is up to her old tricks. I'll have a little talk with her, but I see you've mended your ways, my son, and changed for the better. You have experienced deep and abiding love, the very first in our family. I think this girl is good for you. Are you, I wonder, good for her? Let's ask her.
In an instant, Psyche stood before him, still drugged with sleep.
Awake at once. Morpheus, return to the land of sleep. My child, I am Zeus, Eros' father. You are on Olympus now, safe with us. You are no longer hungry or thirsty. And Morpheus has returned to the land of sleep. Now, may I ask you, why do you seek my son?
I love him.
How do you know?
I loved him first when I heard the sound of his voice, felt the touch of his hand, but...
But?
I didn't trust my feelings. I hurt him.
You are young. It happens. And now?
Now I love him with all my heart and soul. Eros joins her. They are face to face at last. And I, you.
It is good, then. Psyche, drink this cup of ambrosia. You have beauty, it is true. But more importantly, you possess kindness. You have shown courage. You have been transformed by your trials and your love. From now on and forever, you are immortal and shall live among the gods. Strike up the trumpets, the viols, and drums. Let's hear the celestial music. All now welcome Psyche here with us this day. And Eros, her husband, all shout hooray!
Hooray! Hooray!
And just a year from this joyous day, a baby girl was born. They named the baby Joy.
Aphrodite holds the baby with Psyche and Eros on each side. You two run along, I'll babysit. They get on the fly cycle. Have you ever seen a more beautiful child? She's got her mother's pretty eyes, as blue can be, and her father's chin and his curly hair. But she looks a lot like her old grandma. She looks an awful lot like me. Curtain up.